What's the story with Mario's?
The sign, I can see it's pretty big. Well, it came from the Wells Fargo's bank that I think it was one here on in Capitola that was going out of business, and I guess the person that was taking down the letters for the sign knew my dad and brought them over here to see if he was interested in them, and that's kind of what he did. He took the letters and built his name off of it. And the W for Wells Fargo got flipped straight down as an M now.
Does it light up?
Yeah. No, it doesn't light up. He's gonna do that next, actually. That's what he's gonna do on the inside. So that's kind of what you got there. Kind of works for both his studio and my studio. We're both Mario. I'm Mario Jr. So it's kind of what you get. Setting up downtown, they require you that you set up some sort of display, some kind of table or something to make yourself presentable.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did is I got smart and wanted to build something on wheels so that I could get down there and just set up really quickly. And that's basically what this is. It's kind of like a little cabinet table on wheels with space on the inside to put my product on the sides. And this wall just kind of just gets thrown up. I put my graphics everywhere, set up the hats, greeting cards, and just whatever I have on the go, you know. It's kind of something quick and easy. And it's cool. It's almost like having like a little gallery. It's got a back wall too that usually has graphics too, so people can kind of walk around it, look at the art, and see if they want something.
Now, you usually do this just for only First Fridays, or do you go out there just every now and again?
Every now and again, but usually a lot during the summer because we have so many like tourists coming to town.
Mm-hmm.
That it's worth going out there all the time because you just encounter so many different types of people that want to bring something back home from Santa Cruz.
This is all your paintings right here, correct? Well, most of them, correct? And these are all your prints that you have on hand?
Yeah, mostly that's all like my graphic design that's kind of like quick and easy and, you know, easy to print, and they're all mostly like one or two different sizes. So they're a nice thing to have just, you know, if you're just hitting up, you know, downtown or some party or something, they're just...
Yeah, see, some of these prints also like incorporate digital along with, you know, like this one, actual pictures and photography as well. Does photography play a big part in your paintings as well?
In my digital media, sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't. It just, I carry my camera all the time with me, so I'm constantly taking pictures outside as well, and I incorporate that from illustration to Photoshop and kind of build on that to make these graphics.
So explain this one right here. Break this one down.
Like that one, that one's an Egyptian cat that I made, and that one has a background of a painting of that I did, made it kind of look like a universe in the background.
Mm-hmm.
Brought that in through my scanner to my computer, uploaded it, and then was able to build around it in the shape of a cat and put shapes around it. So kind of a complicated piece, but it's kind of simple too in a way.
Because when I first saw that, I kind of thought of Aztecs.
Yeah.
Was that kind of the influence on that, or?
Yeah, I'm into definitely kind of like in ancient kind of, you know, different takes on that. Definitely Egyptian and Mayan kind of work, anything Aztec. I mean, I've been to Mexico. My parents are from Mexico, so I've kind of traveled a little bit down there and been able to see some of these places and see the hieroglyphs and the pyramids. And I guess it's just something I've always been kind of fascinated in, you know.
And how long have you been doing these shirts?
The shirt's probably only like a year and a half. It took me a while.
Really?
To start actually screen printing. It's actually what you see in the back here. It's like it's a screen press. And it took me a while to get all the different things that I needed for it. Just the screens, the screen press, the emulsions, the inks. And you needed, you know, the room to be able to do that here.
Uh-huh.
And a light box. And that's actually what this box behind you is.
This giant one right here?
Yeah, the screens go in there, there's a light that exposes it, and it just kind of burns the screens there.
Can you print? Oh, I'm gonna cut you off.
No.
Go for it.
I just do it directly from here.
So you do it all independently on your own?
All independent, yeah. Just all myself. It's kind of a crazy thing, because I've got my hands tied in so many different types of mediums. If it's not painting, it's drawing. The drawings turn into screens to make t-shirts, and a lot of illustration as well on the computer, photography, just I don't know, just the arts have always just kind of run in my blood, I guess. You know, a lot of my family are artists, so just took it from there.
Okay, so it's safe to say it's inherited, the art?
I definitely would say so. Yeah, my mother can draw really well and paint really well, and my dad, he's an electrician and restores lamps, so he's a kind of a crazy artist in his own way too. He works a lot with metal and wood, and I kind of learned a lot from him, kind of took it from there, molded it into myself. We have a lot of bridges and tunnels out here in Santa Cruz, and I would go out with friends and you know, do that sometimes, just go out and paint on walls, and sometimes I'd go on myself, you know, just with like a flashlight and stuff, and I would just paint. And it was that a lot of my friends got busted, you know, a lot of them got tickets and fines and got arrested, and I quickly saw that, you know, how big of a deal it is to get busted for, and it didn't seem like the right avenue for me to go down, you know, mm-hmm. to pursue that. So I kind of just took it to the studio. I wanted to create more things that were, you know, gonna last and be on the canvas, and someone could take it home, be on a wall or whatever. With street art, it's, you know, its lifespan's usually just like a day or a week at the most.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, tagged over or paint over it.
And I see, I've been noticing your paintings that you work with a lot of different colors and a lot of different mediums.
See, like they are acrylic, and then these are three-dimensional. These are kind of like shadow boxes, and these are like kind of ink drawings. Then there's like digital media, and that's the crazy thing about it, you know. It's like a lot of artists, you know, they stick to one or two things, you know, and they grow strongly with that. But for me, it's like I have trouble like touching so many different types of mediums and mm-hmm. not, you know, falling in love with it, you know. It's like I find everything so fun, you know, whether it's watercolor, whether it's acrylic, woodworking, illustration. It just all kind of reaches out, and it's similar in a way, but different by its medium.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what you get here with me. It's just kind of, you know.
Yeah, you get like a whole different vibe.
Yeah. So I'm always busy. I'm always busy with so many different types of things. It's kind of crazy.
Now, I know you said as like an artist, you have to grow and expand your horizon and your tools. Mm-hmm. But out of the techniques that you use, which one's your favorite to work with?
My favorite, painting.
Painting?
Painting. And it's like the hardest as well, also. It's just, I don't know. It was something that I've desired early on, was to take my drawing to painting, and I couldn't do it at first. It was very difficult to control the paint,
mm-hmm.
and I just kept at it, and along the way, I've learned a lot of different kinds of techniques just from experimenting in it. Something about just working with layers, you know, just shading and putting colors on top of colors and having them overlap and just having them raw on wood or canvas or whatever it is, you know, and just, I love painting. I'd have to say painting. My least? I like painting too.
You gotta take it hand in hand,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, no, it's tough sometimes. Sometimes paintings take so long that it's just like, it gets so tedious, just like, just move away from it. It's like, I gotta do something else. So I go to drawing, you know? Drawing, all it is pen and marker, so it's a lot quicker. But my least favorite, I don't know. It's hard to choose one. Maybe watercolor. It's a little difficult for me to control.
Mm-hmm.
You know, color while it's under just a lot of water.
Still sitting here with Mario, and we're going to be breaking down some of his paintings. He picked out two, and I picked out two. So we're going to talk about the honey hive right here. The 3D honey hive right up there. So explain the inspiration for that one right there, for that piece.
That one just sort of came about just being fascinated with bees and kind of things that they construct and what they do. Basically, they're incredibly important for our ecosystem. You know, we need them to be able to pollinate our plants to keep the crops going.
Mm-hmm.
And recently, there's been, you know, a lot of bees kind of disappearing and just, you know, leaving and dying. And it's due to, you know, just like the climate change and just the pesticides and just all the chemicals that they use on people's, you know, crops. So this piece right here was a little bit kind of inspired from what I was hearing a lot about what the bees were going through. And I wanted to make something that looked three-dimensional, where you saw the inside of a comb of what they construct with like the hexagons and the patterns inside.
Mm-hmm.
So I left that for the inside of it, kind of like you're looking into a beehive, and then the outside's kind of like the...
supposed to be like a tree?
Kind of like a tree, yeah. And it's all textured, and you can see the holes where they go would go in and out, you know. It's a little bit exaggerated, you know. They don't really have holes like that, but I wanted the viewer to kind of get a glimpse of what they see.
The inner workings of a bee?
Yeah, the workings of a bee. So I thought that was a little bit interesting.
Different. Now, what'd you use to make that piece happen?
For that one, I've been getting really into texturing wood, so I've been kind of using kind of like axes and picks and just been chipping away at wood and sanding them, filing them, and then staining them with the, you know, different types of paint and putting varnishes over them kind of gives it that depth and feel for the paint.
You know, to the normal eye, that actually looks like an actual bark.
Yeah, the colors are just kind of really well done to capture that.
And then moving on to this one right up here, is that explain that one right there.
That one, which I actually just finished like last night, I literally just put that one up. That one has a similar background, but it's a little bit more kind of green.
Is that supposed to represent the trees?
Sort of just the tree. That one has not a real kind of concept behind, other than it's mostly an experimental piece. And since I've been doing more three-dimensional pieces, I went ahead with that one and started with the background, kind of chipping it up, staining the wood, giving it kind of that rough look. And what's interesting about that one is like the plants you see in the back,
mm-hmm.
those are actually printed from actual ferns and leaves that I used. I cut them down and I had the idea that if I could apply paint to them, put them on the wood, on the canvas, whatever, and somehow use a roller over them,
yeah.
I thought maybe, possibly, it would leave the print kind of like a stamp. I didn't think it would work that well, but it did. That's the outcome. It's got every little detail and depth in it right there.
Yeah, you can actually, you would actually think those are real leaves on there.
Yeah.
That you painted over.
Yep, so I didn't actually paint that. I was just all from plants that I used as stamps, and it kind of gave it that look for the background. And then, so it built up from a few layers like that, and then up to the forefront where I used driftwood and different types of bark that I had, and just kind of sliced them apart and added kind of wood to them. Those are all glued and drilled on there, but it has kind of a very kind of nature forest look and feel to that piece, and it's different. It's definitely a different approach.
Now that's your first, not your first, but is that one of your first 3D experimentals right there?
Yeah, that one is the second one next to this one right here. This little one right here.
That beaver dam?
Yeah, that's like kind of, yeah, like a beaver dam. That's kind of the first one where I took the wood rounds, was that one. And there's new, something different. People seem to be liking these three-dimensional ones, kind of like the shadow boxes, so... see where we go with those ones from there.
This one's interesting, the woman with the...
Like, oh, the gypsy woman with the bird?
Yeah, what's the concept behind that? What inspired that drawing?
Was a bit melancholy, where, you know, on one side you have that a tree that's kind of just dying, it's got no life, it's got, you know, no leaves or anything, and on the other side it's blossoming with color and it does have life, and that's where the gypsy woman kind of reaches out and holds the bird there above the sun. So it's kind of a balance of both, you know.
So it's supposed to like symbolize kind of like hope for the bird?
Yeah,
or like hope?
It's positive and negative, and you know, the positive usually always rises above the negative, so take on that one.
And then this one right here, this is probably my favorite. Kind of reminds me of Donnie Darko. So explain this one right here.
This one is a piece of some of my graphic design. I've been doing a lot of different kinds of animals, and this one is an antelope, where I kind of use different kinds of patterns in him, in his skin and everything with his fur, and had some mountains and kind of swirling clouds around him.
Mm-hmm.
But what was interesting was I left it very dark, kind of just a lot of gray tones, and then kind of touched it with the horns being kind of like candy cane.
Yeah.
They just kind of like immediately pop out. They look so different than what's around it, you know?
Now, what's the inspiration for this, though? Why would?
It looks a little kind of Christmas, kind of Christmas-like. I don't know. I wanted to do an animal with horns, and the antelope was one that has kind of crazy, twisty kind of horns like that. And they don't necessarily have those colors. I just thought I would kind of exaggerate on it and kind of make it look a little more cartoony or animated. So that's kind of what I wanted to do.
It kind of has an evil look to it. Was that supposed to be intentional or unintentional?
That's a little evil, but yeah, unintentional. Almost looks kind of devilish, huh? It's red.
Thought this was Where's Waldo's pet, man.
Yeah.
And then final one, the woman crying.
Yeah, it's kind of like a floating hand holding some of her tears, I think. That was another kind of a melancholy piece where, you know, could have been something personal of mine. I don't think it was, but it was just one that was just kind of raining, kind of just really down on himself and kind of touching on that emotion, you know.
Why did you have her hand floating like that? It was just on accident, or did you just like the look of it?
Yeah, I think that actually did happen on accident. I was going to fill in the rest of the arm, but for some reason, it just kind of stood out like that. It was just kind of, you know, pinpointing that its hand was there, and it was focused on that, you know? I was observing what was happening, so it stuck like that.
Because it looks like it's like she's walking through a waterfall.
Yeah, it's like it's her tears in the background as well. It's kind of
yeah.
Weird. Yeah.
It's really sad, and yeah. You can tell. I mean, she's going through some heartbreak right there.
Yeah. Those drips are kind of crazy. You're right, it does kind of look like a waterfall with tears behind her. Kinda.
What'd you use for the tears?
Water, very run down, kind of barely any acrylic paint on the water. And kind of with that effect, you kind of have to use them as drips, you know. It was just let water run down and apply a bit of paint so that it stays on and still flows down.
Let's talk about this one right here. That one's crazy.
Which one right here?
The one that looks like a Wookiee or an Ewok.
Oh, the Ewok one? That one is kind of a character. I do a lot of like characters and stuff, like these guys with the hoodies and the noses. I like to design my own kind of characters because I'm so influenced from like cartoons, video games, animation, you name it, you know, things that are nostalgic from your childhood. So that one's a bit Star Wars kind of influence, you can tell. I don't know if I was watching Star Wars at the time, but it does kind of look like an Ewok, kind of with his like little hoodie, and it's a little devilish kind of look as well, kind of laughing at you, but bit cartoony, bit different.
As an artist, do you feel you're heading in the right direction in growth and in your artistic creativity?
Yeah, I think definitely I am, because I've just kept curious and I've kept experimenting and kept pushing the envelope, I feel, every time. And just staying original and, you know, every day just doing a little more and more, and it's just kind of building on that, you know. I feel that if you focus on something, you know, and do it long enough, eventually you're going to kind of grow from there and it's going to become something. So, yeah, definitely, I see myself doing this for a while. Right now, yeah, definitely. I feel like I've learned, you know, so much along my way and have met so many different people, and I feel it's just going to continue to grow, you know, just take it as it goes.
What advice would you give an artist?
I would say keep doing it, you know, no matter what anybody says, just work on it any chance you have, you know, just keep going. And eventually over time, like I was saying, you just keep getting better, you know. I wasn't so good at, you know, in the beginning, but I kept going no matter what anybody said, kept doing it, and it got me here, you know, and I love what I do, so it worked out.
Thank you, brother. We appreciate it. Again, same time, same channel. Don't forget, check, bolt. Peace.
Feel the goosebumps from my writtens like I'm R.L. Stein. A coke fiend when I write the way I think about lines. Now they all up in my business like they care about mine. And I don't need to watch my back, I look at my spine. A set of horns on the top of my head, hold up a halo. I'm Richie Real, high like the word hello. The bud I got some perp, I smoke that Donatello. The money come and go, and my dingo my slow.
Like the modern Leonard, breezing through the seven seas. I travel through these nightmares, sweet dreams to give you gems. You could call me Indie Market, the beast, all over me. I'm the last thing these MCs.
Yo, what's up, Dagis? It's your boy, Johnny Zuko. I'm saying here with Mario, founder of Dream Vision Quest, and that's your brand, correct?
Yeah, it's actually pronounced Dream Quest Vision.
Dream Quest. See, it's my dyslexia kicking in. So, hashtag dyslexia.